Dr. Jens Christian Blatt of McKinsey, who is going to talk about commercialization and choosing the right markets and value chains. So we're looking forward very much to this talk. And Dr. Blatt, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. As a discussion starter, I would like to start with 7 statements that need to be considered if you think about commercialization. So if you think about commercialization of green products and green materials, I think there are certain things that you need to be aware of. Yes, first of all, green is important and has entered, I think, the space in the Western society quite tremendously. The second bullet is about end of life is more important, especially recyclability. So if you talk about green, you typically mean, or the majority of people mean, recyclability, and I will go one by one afterwards and explain how we come to these statements. The green enthusiasm varies by segment and by regions. I mean, that is probably or obviously not a surprise for you, but we will also explain which segments are more enthusiastic and which are less. There is a modest premium for green, yes, and I think that's a little bit contradictory to what was reported and what was some opinion in the past. I think there is a green premium. Unfortunately, it's not significant, and unfortunately, you also have to share it along all value chain players. That is the fifth point, and number 6 is don't sacrifice on performance and quality of these products, and I think that's also a key notion. Whatever you do in green, it needs to be at least at par in terms of quality and performance with the fossil-based materials. And the last point is the commercialization is, I would say, provocative. It's a typical commercialization, and it takes a lot of time, yes? And how much time and how long it will take, we will also explore. So what can you do if you talk about a topic of green where you have a lot of opinions, and I think the answer is difficult to get? What we then always do, we ask a lot of people, and we call it a survey, and then we just get at least a feeling of how different groups of people think. Yes? So what we have done, we have made a survey, and we have asked 500 executives, so that are people that either decide or are in the gremium that decide on management decisions. Yes, and on the other hand, we have mirrored this against the consumers, so we have asked 1,000 consumers about certain green trends. What is pretty clear is that the vast majority of consumers and executives, they all agree that green is a major trend or at least a viable alternative. So I think there is no way around this green trend. This is then, I think, also important. Greenness is seen important, but as you also can see here, everything is important that doesn't harm a business. So, I mean, in the end of the day, this outcome is not a surprise, but it's also not really differentiating. Yeah? So green is important as long as it does not harm the business. The challenge that we faced is, what do we mean if we talk about green? And we have said there are several meanings of green. Yes, it's a recycled materials, it is a low carbon footprint materials, it's biodegradable, it could be recyclable, it could be biobased, it could be non-toxic. So all of this could mean green. But what are then the people thinking if they talk about green? And at least the consumers, they have a clear opinion. If consumers talk about green, they typically say it's recyclability. Yes, more than half of all consumers think its recyclability is the most important green attribute. If you then ask the executives, it's a little bit more balanced picture. And if you then look also at the different regions, I think there's also historic reason to it. If you look at the US, you have 2 green attributes named by the executives, which have been named as most important. It's recyclable and toxicity. Yes, I think if the word green chemistry was developed 20, 30 years ago, starting in the US, it was historically meant being non-toxic. Yes, and I think that's also a historical caveat of the meaning of green chemicals. So it's a toxicity, which is quite important, especially in the US. And you see that the US have more a black and white picture, and that Europe and Asia also think that biobased and biodegradability are quite important attributes for green. So you see already here there are big regional differences in the meaning of green. If you then ask the consumers, yes, where is green important? You see, I mean, also in the different end custom industries, the importance is different, yes? So if you talk about packaging, green is very important, yes? If you talk about automobiles and about electronics, it's less important. Yes, however, I think in all of these industries, green is an important trend. So it's not about that green is not relevant in any of these industries. It's just that in packaging, for example, or especially in packaging, it's significantly more important than in others. Then we've also asked the executives questions like, which share of your customer base require being constantly served with green products? Yes, that's the left part here. Yes, if you then look at the answers, it's clear that the European executives and companies, they think that 40%, so nearly half of their customers, require constantly green products. Yes, if you then, and Asia includes already also China and India, and I think that was a little bit of a surprise, that the US has a significantly lower expectations of their customer industry. So green is not really required in the US. To make it provocative, it's important, most important in Europe, but it is also important and gained importance in Asia. Yes, if you then look at the customer industry, you also get a differentiated picture, especially that automotive is, I think, in the end, is not a surprise, but I think there's also a trend that is more to environmental friendliness, which is also not always considered as green, yes, because if you think at all the hybrid cars and Toyota Prius and so on, I mean, there is some green chemistry in it, and I think the trend will go into this direction, but it's also partially driven by the chemical industry. Now we have seen green is important, and it's different important for different industries and sectors. Now the key question for us was, I mean, how much worth is green? Yes, how much do you would like to pay more for a green product? Yes, and if you see here for different end customer industries, you typically see 5% more. Yes, the vast majority is willing to pay 5% more here from the end consumer side. Yes, at 10% more, you are less more or less break even with 50% hurdle rate. Yes. If you then talk about, would you be willing to pay 20 or 30% more, just a very limited share of consumers would like to pay this. And if you then look at this in a more scientific way, you see here then the curves. And if you say, you then think, I mean, about 50% of the consumers are typically willing to pay a premium at the end of the value chain of 15 to maybe 20% in some extreme cases. Yes, and packaging being the segment where consumers are willing to pay the highest premium, also in terms of perception. That is also nicely mirrored of what executives think the green premium will be at the end of the value chain. Yes, so it's my regional differences and some product differences, but overall, I think there is a green premium in the range of whatever 15 to 20% at the end of the value chain. So that is already good news for green. There is a green premium. The bad news is, as a chemical industry, you will not get the full green premium, yes? Now we've also asked the executives what price increase, yes, or what price increase would you accept from your raw material supplier if they supply you a product with a green attribute. Yes, and on average, you see, they are willing to pay 7 to 11% more for green attributed materials, yes, meaning there is a gap of 10%, which also means, I mean, players along the value chain, they would like to make margin out of green. Yes, so it's not that someone is in green because he thinks green is nice to have, but I mean, they would like to make margin. It's about profitability that drives the penetration of green in the value chain. I think then there's also the discussion, how important is green? So if you have to make a trade-off between green and non-green alternatives like quality, like performance, like cost, and like regulatory compliance, yes, in all of these dimensions you see green is less important. Yes, so if it comes heart to heart and you need to make a trade-off, green is not the priority. Yes, that is also, I think, in line with what we've seen, that I think typically investment decisions are driven by profitability. Yes, although there might be a green premium and there's some regulation required, but would you sacrifice part of your performance just for being green if there's no other benefit for you? I mean, the answer, or the comparably clear answer, is no, you would not. That may be as a little introduction of things and facts you need to be aware of. This is now about commercialization. How far will it go? Because I think there was 5 years ago, there was a hype of green chemistry, and it was comparably new and penetrated with the first products. And this hype has sometimes been a little bit disappointing, yes? And I think we can also discuss whether it's really disappointing or whether it's really what should have been expected, yes? I mean, the innovation potential of, if you now go to the polymer space, of fossil-based polymers is more or less exploited, yes? And now the key question is, biopolymers, is it a new wave? Could it create a new wave? And I think at least the start is, I would call it more promising, yes? I think it's not disappointing, it's promising. Because what you have to be aware of, the commercialization typically takes time and takes a long time. Yeah, we're not talking about months, we're talking about years and maybe even some decades, yes? So if you take, for example, the start of PLA, yes, after the commercial introduction, PLA has behaved like many other polymers, yes, like polypropylene in the beginning, PVC in the beginning, or polystyrene in the beginning, yes. So there's not a surprise that PLA is not have the breakthrough from one day to the other. I think there's it is in line with what could be expected. We have also looked at different polymers, yes, and we have looked at different applications, yes. And what you see here is one interesting fact. If you look at 34 examples, and the chart is maybe a little bit outdated, but I think the message is still valid. Yes, you think most of these, and that are really high volume applications, most of these polymers have found their applications either in the first 3 years or a significant part after more than 10 years. So if you develop a polymer today, which is a new polymer, don't expect that you find the final application with the highest volume within the next 5 to 10 years. It could take even longer, yes? So that is also, I think, a message which need to be clear. I mean, first of all, you don't know what the market really needs and where this is required. If you then also look at the time to volume, yes, we call time to volume, so from the commercial start to a significant market volume of 300 million pounds here, you see that, I mean, in a certain commodity plastics, it takes on average 10 years until you reach a significant market size. For engineering plastics, it's significantly longer, but also driven because you have higher performance, the market in volumes is overall smaller, yes. But if you then add up these two things together, yes, you might need up to 10 years finding the right application, and then if you found it, you need another whatever 10 years plus to make it really a sizable market, then we are easily at 20 years that you need to wait until you have made out of a new polymer a really sizable and significant market. This all is true if you have new materials, which is completely not true, and that also fueled, I think, the discussion in the initial years about drop-ins, yes? If you think about green polyethylene, in the end of the day, it doesn't matter. I mean, the properties of polyethylene are known, and whether the polyethylene or the ethylene comes from sugar or from oil, it doesn't make a difference in the property of the product. So, I mean, for these exceptions, for the drop-ins, I mean, there the commercialization goes significantly faster, yes? I mean, essentially you're talking about how much long do you need to build a plant, yes? And that's typically 2 to 3 years, and then you're there. So how do you now need to think about if you would like to commercialize a product? Yes, and we also say there are two things that you need to be aware of. One is the impact on the total cost of the product. This is somehow a little bit of a tricky dimension because you need to understand that the total cost of the product often, especially for packaging, is just a minor share. However, we call it's a significant part of the influential cost. Yes, so there's someone sitting in an organization whose target it is to reduce the purchasing amount for some packaging materials. Yes, and so he will have a clear focus on packaging, even if it's just 1 or 2% of the overall product value. If someone optimizes this, and that's often the case also for packaging, then you need to be cost competitive. And the value created by the polymer, I mean, that is clear, or by the green material, I mean, that needs to be at least at par with the alternative from the fossil route, at least if you are at the same price level, yes? What makes it more tricky is, and you see here one example for green polyethylene, is you need to look at this at a very granular perspective, yes? So it's not like you can say my PLA is good for packaging, but you really need to differentiate between packaging, where exactly is it used, Yes, and it's more about, is it a bottle for milk? I mean, what about the whatever oxygen barriers? What about barriers for oil? And all these properties need to be assessed. And typically, especially in the beginning, new materials have certain weaknesses that need to be overcome. Yes, and if you then would like to see what happened to PLA, I mean, you just need to go down to the exhibition floor and talk to the different players, and you see there's a lot of research and innovation potential going on, starting with PLA now to make stereo complex PLA sorts and copolymers and so on. Yeah, so I think that's also the drawback of certain green things. If they are really new, you need to optimize them a lot, and you typically start with certain applications which fit to the property profile of the material, yes, and typically it is something like disposables in the beginning. So packaging is typically quite attractive as an entry market, but this might change over time. Maybe now this as an end, and I mean this was a little bit of a screenshot and highlight, and maybe a little bit fast. Four things you should take away. First of all, reject the no one will pay myth. I mean some customers, not all, but some will pay a premium, and it's partly it is a significant premium. Yeah? So we're not talking about 1-2%, but up to 20%, a significant share of consumers is able to pay. The second one is you need to carefully choose the segments, and the target should not be just find the segment with which you're targeted in the end right away. It's more like, I would say, the hula hoop phenomenon. Just find a segment for enter the market so that people get familiar with the polymer, with the plastic, with the properties. And once they are known and once you are known, I mean, then you can make the next step. So it's not like one step approach, but just make a journey with your products. The third bullet is, I think you need to solve the value chain, and you don't need to solve, I think, just one step in the value chain, yes? I have talked to some people who've just said, I have a new product, it had great properties, but I mean, sometimes the value chain is not ready for it. Yes, if it's a new polymer and the molding compound is not, the molding compounder cannot handle this polymer, I mean, you will not able to sell it. Yes, so I think look upfront of with whom you could cooperate and collaborate to enable, I think, and to solve the value chain dilemma. And the last point, and that is really, I think, a very important point, is do not sacrifice on performance and quality of materials. Yes, I think it is an absolutely no-go, even if you're a little bit cheaper, if your quality and performance is not at par with the fossil alternatives. Good, I think that was a brief introduction.